Ladies and gentlemen, let's have a huge round of applause for each one of our guests and our session moderator, Rajdeep. It's over to you.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Democracy, demography, and demand. The three D's may sound complicated, but effectively, when translated, they reflect on a single word, J, which is jobs. And I think the biggest challenge, as our successive Mood of the Nation polls are showing, is that of providing jobs to India's young. We heard from Sonia Gandhi about what she believes is her vision for reimagining India. But let's be clear, you cannot have an India where millions of people remain jobless. And without the rhetoric, we will try on this debate at the India Today Conclave, try and find a solution to the vexed issue of jobs. Please welcome Sachin Pilot, the Congress President in Rajasthan, and seen by many as the poster boy and the face of a new Congress. Jayant Sinha, Minister of State in the government of Narendra Modi. And remember, he's MOS Civil Aviation. And since the Civil Aviation Minister resigned yesterday, I presume he's the man in charge. Also with us, Uday Kotak, the person who's transformed private banking in the country, one of the country's leading businessmen. Arvind Panagriya, the former chairperson of the Niti Aayog, economist, and really someone who's modeled the thinking of the Narendra Modi government. And also welcome Mr. Professor Mohan Guruswamy of the Center for Policy Alternatives, economist who has an alternative view on most issues. Give a bigger hand, ladies and gentlemen, come on. I'm going to start with you, Jayant Sinha, since the first session was dominated by the Congress Party and Sonia Gandhi. And there was one statement that she said that stuck in my mind. She said, politicians lie at election time, throw up jumlas. Now, one of the jumlas that she didn't refer to, but many critics of this government refer to, is the Prime Minister's promise of creating 1 crore jobs annually. Was that a jumla, or was that actually a goal that you had set for yourself, which 4 years later you've been unable to achieve?
Thank you very much, Rajdeep, for giving me the opportunity to respond to that very direct statement. First of all, you know, I have come into public life fairly late in my career, and you know, my career has been that of a businessman and an engineer. So I'm very much driven by the facts. So not by jumla, but by the facts. So let's talk about the facts. I think you need to change the title of this talk. It's not about missing jobs. It's about the missing data. And I think Dr. Panagariya, when he was at the Niti Aayog, really understood that. And of course, Niti is now doing a very detailed study to actually collect the right data, the facts on the jobs. And what the facts are telling us now, not the jumla, though that might be good political rhetoric to use, what are the facts telling us? The facts are telling us that we are not picking up all of the job creation that is actually happening in the economy. You have seen what the EPFO study that was done by the two Ghoshes showed, which showed that 60 to 70 lakhs a year of jobs are being created. 6 to 7 million jobs a year are being created through the EPFO data. We know through the Mudra Yojana, we've given 4 lakh crore of loans to about 10 crore people. That is, of course, micro-entrepreneurship, but that is self-employment, that is also productive enterprise. And then, of course, the other third very important factor is that the data is not picking up all the jobs that are being created in the new economy. Ola and Uber themselves are employing close to 1 million, 10 lakh drivers, self-employed drivers right now. None of the data, and of course, Dr. Panagariya will give us the exact understanding of this, none of the data right now is picking that up. So there is, in fact, a tremendous amount, an upsurge in job creation that is happening, but it is not happening in the traditional economy as we are seeing everywhere else around the world. It's happening in the new economy, it's happening in entrepreneurship, it's happening in new kinds of jobs. And that's really what we need to understand if we want to understand the job picture. I'll close by saying once again, it's not about the missing jobs. It's about the missing data on jobs.
So you believe Sonia Gandhi was lying when she suggested that the BJP was lying?
I let the people of India come to that conclusion. I'm going to stick to the facts, Rajdeep.
I'm glad you didn't refer to pakoda sellers. You've referred to Ola and Uber drivers. Because the Prime Minister chose to refer to pakoda sellers when the same question was asked to him about
Rajdeep,
jobs.
Rajdeep, if you come to Hazaribagh in my hometown, I'll take you to Jhanda Chowk. We have Satya Narayan ji, jinke pakode aur dhuska agar aap khareed ke dekhenge aur unki kamai roj ki dekhenge, to aap bhi kahiyega ki main anchor chhodkar pakoda wala ban jata hun.
I'll come back with a response to that later. But Sachin Pilot, respond to what you've just heard. Is there a sense that the Congress also uses selective data, as does the BJP? You've got Jayant Sinha referring to the reports of Ghosh and Ghosh, which are effectively on EPFO numbers, which would suggest that, in a sense, the job situation is not as bad as the Congress makes it out to be.
Rajdeep, to my mind, it's not about whether the Congress or the BJP finds the job situation good or bad. It's not even really, frankly, about, like Mr. Sinha said, about the data. It's about what's on the ground. Now, a CSO study will give you X data, a Ghosh and Ghosh study will give you Y data. But if you go out on the streets, and just yesterday I was in a district in Rajasthan, the point is that retailers, people involved in the agricultural ecosystem, the young people who are educated, are either underemployed or unemployed. And the fact that the aspirational India, which we are so proud of, the median age in this country is 27. If these people are not gainfully employed, if they're not skilled enough, 40% of people who are going out to seek jobs are underskilled. So companies have to retrain them. So the entire system is dismantling. I don't agree with the fact that there are enough jobs being created in industries that are not being captured by the data. The problem is that there are not enough skill development going on. In fact, even this skill mission that the new government has started is basically a national skills mission of the previous government being rebranded, which they're very good at. But the fact of the matter is that this country is now honestly at a turning point where if we don't take care of the young, this dividend is not only going to vanish, it'll be a huge burden on our economy. And it's actually about the policy making, because if the exports are down, if the agricultural income is half what it was, if GDP is only fudged in numbers, you can't have investments and job creation. You've got to shift tens of millions of people who work on the farmland onto the shop floor and then onto the service sector. You really cannot imagine in India growing at 7-8% with a jobless growth. I'm saying it very categorically. The growth that we see is numerical. We don't see the young people. People are laying off, wages are falling, and there is retrenchment in large industries. Companies that have three shifts working are now working on two shifts. So the data is for all of us to see. The fact is, what are we doing as state governments and government of India to make sure that we create that incentivization for job creation to take place? Sadly, that's not happening enough.
You know, it's very easy for you to sit in the opposition and say all this. You've been a minister for corporate affairs. Let's be clear. You offer me the solution. You know, we can identify the problems in this country very easily. As a young leader, give me the solution to the job crisis.
The first point is, we cannot live in denial. You cannot say that it's not a problem. First of all, accept the problem. Second of all, I think, and I've been saying this for a long time, we've got to link industry to economic institutions. We are having graduates doing courses which are unemployable. So you've got to have industry on a demand basis, making young boys and girls learn what they need to learn.
Isn't that what Skill India is all about?
But Skill India, what is that? What's happening? Skill India, money's been allocated. There is huge problems, at least in my state, I've seen NGOs, etc., taking money. Delivery is not happening on the ground. So you allocate money, you make budgets, you do announcements, but the execution is shoddy. And then in the end of the day, the people who bear the brunt of all this is the young people. And if you don't have that problem sorted out now, we're looking at a deep, deep crisis.
Before I come to the other three speakers, I want a quick response. This is not a television studio debate, so it doesn't necessarily have to be a tutu meme. But let's at least get you to concede that your government lives in denial, Jayant Sinha.
But to his credit, I think Mr. Sinha is one person in this government who does not do tutu meme. He's a very sophisticated way of putting things, but the facts don't change, Mr. Sinha. You may say it nicely, but the data does not change. The facts don't change.
Are you living in denial? Are you somewhere, Jayant Sinha, living in denial that there is a serious crisis of jobs? It's not necessarily something that is the creation of the Narendra Modi government, But it is a reality that young India has to live with today. 34.1% of this country's population is between 17 and 29. And large numbers of them, we can debate the figures. ILO will give you a large figure of 18 million people who are unemployed today. Do you concede that there is a serious problem or not?
As far as jobs are concerned, Rajdeep, and I agree with Sachin there, which is that we have to meet people's expectations as far as the kind of jobs that they want. And that is a big challenge for us or for any other government. We are certainly not living in denial. In fact, if you go back and you look at the manifesto we had prepared in 2013-14, that recognizes that. That is why we set such a high aspiration for ourselves as far as jobs are concerned. That's why we created the Skill Development Ministry. That's why every proposal that goes to Cabinet has a section on how many jobs that we are going to create. So there is no question of denial. All of the initiatives, all of the work that we've undertaken is to create jobs for our young people and meet their expectations. Now, are we creating jobs to the extent that we would like to and aspirationally address people's expectations? The answer is we've got work to do. There is no doubt about it. But of course, remember, this is a $2.5 trillion economy. We have to employ hundreds of millions of people. It's not possible in 3 or 4 years to be able to meet all of those demands. The trajectory that we are on, the kind of initiatives that we've undertaken, and as I said, what the facts show us in terms of job creation, all of them tell us that we are absolutely on the right trajectory. We are creating high quality jobs, entrepreneurship and innovation, new industries like aviation, my own sector, are booming, and economic growth is strong. So we are on the right trajectory. And with respect to denial, Sachin knows it well. He is somebody who's with the people all the time, as am I. I'm a Lok Sabha MP. All the time, this is what we spend discussing with our people, is
right.
How do we create better jobs? So there's no question of denial. Are we on the right trajectory? Absolutely. Can we do more? Absolutely. And every moment of every day, I can assure you, Rajdeep, we are accountable to the people of India. That's a sacred responsibility. And we will strive to do better every day.
Uday Kotak, you're not a politician, so you can tell us the truth. Are we on the right track or not? The minister says we are on the right track. How bad is the situation? Am I being a good journalist and, as usual, exaggerating the nature of the crisis? Is there a crisis in the first place?
I think on the journalist point, Rajdeep, unless you exaggerate, how will you get viewers and audience? So that's a fair point. Let me just go back to some data which has come out in 2017 by an ACER study. And I think we are focusing too much on outcomes. The problem is in the inputs towards the outcomes. This is rural youth between the age of 14 and 18. 57% of this rural youth do not know how to do division. 42% do not or are unable to read English. And the last one is a shocker. 41% do not know how to read a time on a watch. This is age 14 to 18 rural youth. And this is a study by ACER. 2017. Therefore, if we want to solve the jobs problem, it is a deep-rooted correction which we need to our skilling and education system. And we see governments in power, there have been a variety of steps, but this is across decades and generations that we need to fundamentally change the basis of how we look at jobs. And three areas where I think the most number of jobs can happen is education, healthcare and security services. And in these three areas, the government can directly hire people in category 3, and in 1 and 2, which is education and healthcare, it has to be an enabler. And these three are significantly underinvested from a jobs point of view. But Rajdeep, moving on to a broader subject, and this is what worries me as a Indian and beyond politics. 60s and even early 70s, India and China were at more or less the same levels of GDP. Today, in 2016-17, India's per capita GDP per capita is about $1,800. China, nearly five times at $8,500. For India to catch up with China for the next 20 years, we need per capita GDP of 8%. And then if you add growth in capita, 9% per annum GDP growth for 20 years to reach where China is today. And I think that is what we must focus on. And I believe in addition to government, if we want jobs, it has to be private sector. And private sector, has to responsibly focus on creating these jobs. It is not the job of government alone. And it is here that we need to transform mindsets of people in India and move beyond short-termism, which is also prevalent in private sector, to create sustainable growth in the economy.
It's interesting you draw the China-India comparison, because some would say the advantage that China had is that they couldn't carry out a public debate of the kind we are carrying out here at the India Today Conclave. They would simply push ahead with policy making. They wouldn't have a Sachin Pilot and a Jayant Sinha arguing at each other, because they don't have a political system. Right? They would have someone like Uday Kotak as the advisor to the Chinese Premier, and you and the Chinese Premier could decide for yourselves how you're going to create those additional jobs.
I think it's a fair question, but nowadays you've got to be very careful about advisors. If you look at the United States example, they seem to be changing advisors every week. So that's the price you pay in a democracy. And I suppose India, for all its challenges coming out of democracy, is much better off having a democracy rather than having that kind of a system.
You know, Uday Kotak doesn't want to be the advisor to the Prime Minister, but Arvind Panagriya, in a strange way, you were, right? And your experience, does it suggest that government is the answer to India's job crisis? Or is it, as Uday Kotak seems to suggest, at the end of the day, that it's the private sector whose animal spirits will have to be unleashed? And that really is the solution. We don't need a Niti Aayog as yet another talk shop. We actually simply need a system that unleashes the entrepreneurial energies of this country, which simply hasn't happened and can't happen through slogans like Make in India, needs to happen on the ground.
Well, so let me just make two or three points here. First of all, I think this talk of jobless growth is nonsense.
It's nonsense.
Talk of jobless growth. Because you cannot have grown. So 4 years, this last 4 years, we have grown at the average rate of 7.3%, inclusive of the current fiscal year, which is ending on March 31st. Now, you are telling me that with the same inputs, year in, year out, you are producing 7.3% more. That's simply not feasible. And capital alone is not doing it either, because capital growth has also slowed down. So employment has to be growing. That's, you know, it is a sad thing that our five-yearly surveys that used to bring in the employment and employment surveys, which are household-based surveys, which are the only definitive ways to find out what is happening to the jobs in aggregate. Because, you know, everything else we do is on specific sectors, but we don't know what is happening in the sectors that are uncovered. So household surveys are the only ones that cover the entire country. That is something, the last one, good, reliable one, happened in 2011-12. And so now the next one, when it comes out, 17-18 survey, we'll find out that the jobs have grown. The real problem we have is that of underemployment rather than unemployment. Problem of good jobs versus a job. Today, at least, you know, people who employ workers, typically, you know, Manish Sabharwal, who employs contract workers, he would tell you that 15 years ago, people used to come to him and say, ki bhai, koi naukri dilwa do. But today he says, everybody comes in and says that naukri to mere paas hai, par achhi naukri dilwao. 6,000, 7,000, 8,000 rupees ki naukri jo ho, aisi naukri dilwao. So I think your problem is really that people are not being employed at their full productivity potential. I think that is where the real action is. This is where I have argued that, and this is where I think, you know, we also tend to, I mean, I'm glad actually Uday is really one of the most progressive industrialists, entrepreneurs, that he brought in the issue of the private sector. Because we give a free pass to the industrialists. What have our industrialists themselves done to focus on the jobs?
What have you done to incentivize industry could turn around and say?
That's a very fair question. And the answer is that, you know, I understand that the individual entrepreneurs would react to what the policies are. And that's perfectly reasonable. But as industry associations, CII, FICCI, they got a social responsibility to some degree. What have these associations have done to come to the government and say that, look, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, do these 10 things. And we assure you that we'll create 10 million jobs.
Uday, you want
have
to respond?
They done it?
You want to respond to Professor Panagriya? Industry will come to the India Today conclave and blame government. What has industry done to create jobs?
I think, Rajdeep, if you look at industry over the last 10 or 15 years, there was disproportionate focus, which was on capital. That means industry was focused on putting capital, most of the time, not the entrepreneur's capital, but the bank's capital. And disproportionate focus on capital as the basis of growth. And jobs were not happening at anywhere near the speed at which capital allocation was happening. So your capital output ratios and capital to job ratios were extremely perverse. However, we also have to keep in mind that there is a pretty significant change out there, which is digital. It is changing the landscape of productivity, which is going to be a global challenge as we are facing. But despite all that, I think there is a few steps in which industry has told government and government has actually acted, which is there is a tax incentive if you have a job created for 240 days in a year under Section 80JJAA, which gives you a 30% break for every new job you create. So there are steps which are being taken, but the issue today is industry in India, in the traditional Lala industrialists, they are in a bit of a stasis and a shock, and that is where I think you're seeing negative jobs. New sectors like IT, Flipkarts, Amazons, Olas, Ubers of the world are creating the jobs, but old industry in India is really destroying jobs as I talk to you.
I don't know how you classify small and medium enterprises and micro industries in this country as old or new, but Professor Guruswamy, CMI, Center for Monitoring Indian Economy, India's employed force fell by 1.5 million from 406.5 million to 405 million during the four-month period, January 17 to April 17. The workforce swelled by 9.7 million to 960 million in this same period. Therefore, in that immediate period after demonetization in particular, there was a sense perhaps that industry got the wrong signal. That far from incentivizing industry to create jobs, in the post-demonetization period, industry fears disruption, and industry, the small and medium sector in particular, which got badly hit, has actually shrunk jobs. Do you go along with that thesis?
I do. Actually,
can you hold it close to you, sir? It's on.
Yeah, what we are now seeing is the highest level of unemployment in the last 17 months. The highest level, and these are government figures.
Highest ever in comparison in the history of the 70 years of
independence. In the last 17 months, you know, it keeps going up and down. So in the last 17 months, this is the highest level we've reached. Now, Jan spoke and Mr. Panagriya both are representing the government. And the first time I'm seeing somebody in denial of
I represent myself.
Of what the government says.
If you can hold it a little closer.
Somebody, the India Employment Report of 2016 says the total unemployed club in India is 117 million. They give data, they break it down. They say 13 million are openly unemployed, 52 are in disguised unemployment, another 52 million are women who don't work. So in all, you have 117 million people out of a population of 1.3 billion without jobs. And that is the reality. You can gloss it over, you say the economy is growing, but the economy is growing and, you know, 1% of the population gets 73% of the growth. That is also growth, but that does not create jobs. Now, the real test is
offer me the solution. Professor Guruswamy, we can throw figures at each other about the problem.
But let me finish. What Uday Kotak said is very important. The biggest indicator of job creation is how much of capital are you deploying? How much of money are you spending? And government leads growth in this country through capital expenditure. That is just not happening. It's been dropping as a percentage of GDP every year. Only 9% of the budget today is spent on capital expenditure. That is, for every 100 rupees we spend for running the government, we spend only 9 rupees on creating something new. Now, without capital expenditure going up to levels of 20-30%, you cannot get growth, you cannot get jobs. You can get growth, you can get sectoral growth, you can get, you know, high growth in sectors which have huge value addition. For IT, it's huge value addition. The value addition in our IT is as big as value addition of the Chinese industrial sector. But does not create jobs. What you need is jobs.
You know, in that, Jayant Sinanthan, I'll get Sachin Pilot to respond. The fear is that this government has resorted to slogans. The slogans are right. Make in India is unobjectionable. But on the ground, translating a slogan into reality has been a huge challenge. You often speak of the second generation of reforms. But the third generation of reform. The third generation of reforms are matched also by disruptive steps like demonetization. I gave you the figures of January to April of 2017. They suggest that far from encouraging and incentivizing industry, demonetization actually pushed industries, small and medium and micro industries, into downsizing. And that's a reality that you've got to deal with without giving me anecdotes about pakoda walas in Hazaribagh or indeed outside my Noida office.
Rajdeep, anecdotes are always good to illustrate a point. But at the end of the day, as I told you, I'm a fact-based scientific person. And exactly as Dr. Panagariya is saying, you have to not look at anecdotes. You can't look at selective interpretations of data. You have to look at good scientific data in the aggregate. As Dr. Panagariya correctly pointed out, you cannot have an economy growing at 7.3% and not create jobs. It's just the way economies work. Inputs lead to outputs. Now, of course, there is a lot of work to be done. We need to create good jobs. And those are exactly the steps that our government is taking. Uday said we have provided incentives in terms of EPFO contributions, in terms of other benefits that we are providing people who create jobs. In addition, we are taking some very important steps on social security. There is a proposal in place now from the Labour Ministry where we are saying that everybody, whether they are working in a formal sector job or an informal sector job, are going to get all the benefits of social security, healthcare, unemployment, life insurance, and so on, so that we take the kinds of jobs that we have right now and make them good, high-quality jobs. Part of the reason why everybody in this country wants a job in the government is because government jobs come with benefits like medical care. With, of course, what we're doing with Ayushman Bharat, with the kinds of incentives that we are providing for job creation on EPFO, what we've done with the Atal Pension Yojana, we are taking jobs, many of which are in the informal sector, pakoda sellers, people working in mobile repair shops, beauty parlors, these kinds of informal sector jobs, and giving them through what we're doing in social security, all of the benefits, all of the security that you get in higher quality jobs. So this, all of this work is underway and you are starting to see the benefits of it. I'll conclude again by saying that jobs are being created. Again, it is a question for us to try and continuously upgrade the jobs, unleash the entrepreneurial energies in the economy, which we are doing through all the things that we've done to promote venture capital, to promote entrepreneurship, Startup India, Stand Up India, all of those things. And those are, in fact, showing up in the aggregate data. It's not about an anecdote here and there. Those are also good to talk to because ultimately we have to catch people's imagination. But at the end of the day, we have to go back as people who are fact-based, as scientific, to the aggregate data, and as Dr. Panagariya pointed out, the aggregate data are very clear.
You know, and the worry is, and this comes also from what Uday Kotak earlier suggested, that if the government brings in these third generation reform, the Congress opposes it. Particularly when you're in the opposition, in your home state of Rajasthan, Vasundhara Raje tried to be disruptive by bringing in what many believe is critical for job creation, labor reform. And she immediately found there was strong opposition both within her party, the RSS, as well as from you. That democracy, in a way, constrains us. China doesn't face the constraints that we would in a state like Rajasthan.
Rajdeep, you have got to stop obsessing about China, because if you were in China, you wouldn't be asking these questions. And I think everybody replied that...
No, I said that. You know, I am obsessing about China because of China's numbers versus your numbers.
I know, but there's always a takeaway. You have great numbers, but we have now a president for life in China. We don't want that in this country. Second point,
we might have a prime minister for life, but that's for another day.
Not if I can help it. But okay, Hear me out. Now, last 17 years, I've been in public life. And one thing I must say, Dr. Panagariya talked about FICCI and CII and Chamber of Commerce. Now, no matter which government it is, no matter who the finance minister is, and no matter what the budget is like, as soon as the budget is finished, you ask any industrialist in CII, FICCI, give ratings on 10, everybody gives 8.5. Every year.
No, they give 11 on 10.
Hang on.
Industry tends to give 11 on 10 to every finance minister.
The point I try to make, Rajdeep, is that it is not the FICCIs and CII of the world who have been elected to office. It is not the responsibility of an industrialist to create jobs. He is there to create investments and to have a productive system. But the promises made by the people who went to elections, who got elected on so-called catching the imagination of giving hard data about 1 crore, 2 crore jobs, doubling of farm incomes. It is those people who are ultimately accountable for where the economy is in the last 4 years. You can't say that industries aren't doing their job. Their job is done, sir, if you stop having tax terrorism, if you stop GST the way it's been implemented, if you stop harassing people, if you stop having, you know, investments, how will it happen? I agree with what Uday Kotak said. It is not up to the government. I think the private sector has a far more greater role to create jobs in this country, like in any other large country. It's the small and medium scale enterprise, of whether it's Japan, Germany, the US, which creates jobs. It's not the top 100 companies in any country. But how will investment take place? You have to have confidence. You can't have a system where the judiciary and the law is second to the strong voice of the political parties. If you have encounters in Uttar Pradesh, if you have Gaurakshaks beating up people, if you have people taking law into their own hands, how will people get the confidence that this country is not going to go the way other nations have gone? So therefore, it is the responsibility of the political class, especially the one with the ruling dispensation, to create a positive, conducive ecosystem where money can come in, a stable growth, a normal tax regime, where people are confident that their money is safe, there is jurisprudence, and there will be job creation in the long run. That will only happen if people take responsibility. Numbers and anecdotes and slogans and jumlas and all, I've heard Skill India, Stand Up India, Digital India, Yoga India. I mean, they're like 15 slogans. 4 years later, what do we have to show for ourselves? And on a lighter note, just yesterday I heard this. One young man was giving a speech in Rajasthan, and it was a farmer's rally. So he said to us, we were sitting on the stage, he says, "Sahab, is sarkar ne chai pila diya, pakode khila diya, shauchale bhej diya, lekin naukri nahi mil rahe hum logon ko." That's what a young man was saying to me.
Okay, you're speaking at this audience with the confidence of one of the few congressmen who seems to be in a state where you're winning at the moment. So I can see where your confidence is coming from, but you make valuable points. You want to respond quickly to that as a former banker yourself, to the fact that the last thing industry needs is disruption. You saw the mild applause that Sachin Pilot got, because I think deep down inside it was not louder because they are worried that they'll be targeted. You know, industry in private conversation keeps telling me that this government has got it horribly wrong. In public conversation, of course, they give 11 on 10 to the Prime Minister, but in private conversation they're saying Narendra Modi's government has let us down. We thought this was going to be a reformist government. It's just the opposite. It's old style socialism at times, borrowed from the Congress in the 70s.
Rajdeep, I thought we were not on a political platform here. We were having a reasoned debate about jobs. Both from your rhetoric and Sachin's rhetoric, it seems like we're descending into the political pit, which of course I'm happy to do if you want, but I shall raise the level of the debate back to a factual and very important, significant for India, discussion on jobs and what we can do about it. I think you have to understand the difference between what Sachin is saying and I'm saying by a statement that he made. And again, it's not political rhetoric. We're talking about what we need to create jobs. Sachin said, and I'll draw your attention to that. He said it is the government's responsibility to create jobs. And therein lies the difference between the way the UPA thinks and the NDA thinks. As far as we are concerned, it's Uday who's going to create the jobs, not Sachin. And it is the private sector that will create the bulk of jobs, will create good jobs. And our focus as government is to put in place the enabling environment, the facilitative policies. Aviation, for example, is booming. Why is it booming? Because we've unleashed market forces. We've unleashed airline companies to be able to go out and provide to Indian consumers the services that they want. And we've done it with a very good enabling environment, which is why they're placing order after order. We've got 550 planes in the sky right now. There are orders for 1,000 planes, because we've created the enabling environment. Even demonetization enabled us to bring down the informal economy, bring down the black economy, increase the formalization of the economy, reduce cash to GDP. All of those goals have been accomplished. And that is exactly what we're doing. The facts are very clear. FDI has gone up to 60 billion. It was about 30, 35 billion during the time of the UPA. Money talks and money is investing in India. The money is coming in, the jobs are being created, and we as a government are creating the framework, the rules, the regulations, which are unleashing the entrepreneurial energies of India, and that's where the good jobs are going to get created. And you're coming back to China. Let me tell you, if we have to compete with China and America and the other countries in the world, India has to be the entrepreneurial engine for the next 6 billion people on the planet, just like the US is the entrepreneurial engine for the top 1 billion people on the planet, we can be the entrepreneurial engine, and we are showing that through the Flipkarts, the Olas, and so on, as to how to be the entrepreneurial engine. That's what our policies are designed to do. We are unleashing our private sector and our entrepreneurs.
Okay, let's come to specifics. And let me also say, it's not as if the aviation sector, with due apologies, sir, only grew post-2014. Open skies policy predates 2014. I'm going to ask you specifics that have happened since 2014 or now need to happen. Let's take it out of Congress versus BJP, UPA versus NDA. Let's look at specifics that can happen. There are no magic bullets, Uday Kotak, but right across the table, starting with you. If you were the country's finance minister in charge of employment generation, what are the ABC things that you would do right away to generate employment?
I think first, I think one of the big areas where India needs to refocus is look at services. Yes, manufacturing is a game, but it's a game which has been played well by some of the other countries and maybe at a time which was earlier. I think the real message for India is serve for India and the rest of the world. How do we create jobs for Indians, for serving the rest of India and the world?
Give me examples. Tourism, for example?
Tourism.
Healthcare.
Healthcare, education, whole area of services, including areas like artificial intelligence, digital. Why can't we be the knowledge and the research capital for the rest of the world? It is a whole new areas of jobs which we need to be thinking about. And manufacturing is changing dramatically. A lot of the traditional manufacturing is becoming more and more service-oriented. Therefore, the piece which is knowledge and service is getting to be a larger and larger piece of the economy. And therefore, while manufacturing is a game we do not give up, let's play the game of the future, which is serve for India and rest of the world. Second, I think we need to transform Indian banking. We have waited too long, and I'm not saying, I'm not getting into the political debate, but we frankly need fewer banks and fewer public sector banks, which may happen through mergers, which may happen through shrinkage, but we need an efficient financial system. We can't be bogged down every few years from time to time where the system gets into a stasis like it is today. India needs the catalyst for financing India's economy, and in addition to banking, the broader services umbrella is our future.
Arvind Panagriya, and you saw Sonia Gandhi's answer. When Arun Puri asked her on bank nationalization, she was very cautious. So I don't know how many governments will have the political will to actually do what you're saying and reduce the number of public sector banks. But Arvind Panagriya, your solutions, three magic bullets if you had.
Well, I believe in walking on two legs. So I want both manufacturing and services. So services Uday has already spoken on. But manufacturing, we cannot give in. I think, you know, today, I'll just give you one example. Garments industry, total export market is $475 billion. We export only $18 billion. This is a sector that creates jobs in hordes. This is where, and this is just one example of light manufacturing. There are millions of this, you know.
But it's still over-regulated.
Sorry?
It's still over-regulated.
Sorry.
Today, young people tell me we don't want to get into manufacturing because it is still the regulatory mechanism is such that it becomes very difficult to get permissions.
It's a huge challenge.
Right.
So therefore, we have to work on those. I'm not denying that. I mean, if the outcome is what it is, there is something that's keeping it from expanding. So we certainly need to do the labor law reforms. We certainly need to do the trade facilitation. We certainly also need to bring in the global firms to the Indian shores. After all, you know, if the Chinese firms that are today, multinationals that are today operating in China, these are not necessarily Chinese firms, but they are operating in China today because of the very high wages. They are moving around. They go to Bangladesh, go to Vietnam. They don't come to the Indian shores. I think we have to do things right so that they come to the Indian shores. So an important part of the solution has to be still getting into the labor-intensive manufacturing, which is where, now remember that you can talk about all the IT stuff which we should do, but 50% of your workforce today is in farm sector, where half of the farms are less than half hectare. Less than half hectare. Who can make a living on that? So you need people to be able to migrate. But what are they going to migrate to? You need to create jobs on to which these people can migrate. An apparel industry, the garments industry is a perfect example. Our biggest exporter, Shahi Exports, tells me that in 6 weeks, they can train a person with fifth grade education to do a job that earns him 15,000 rupees. So why not multiply that sort of jobs?
I think the biggest problem is to create jobs for people without very many skills or with practically no skills. That is your real problem today. And tens of millions are coming into that stream every year. So you got to create jobs there, because whether you like it or not, there still are people and you got to look after them. And you create jobs in the sectors that they spoke about. Plus, the biggest sector, the biggest employer out of farming is construction. You've really got to give a boost to construction. Construction employs about 55 million people. And in this last demonetization, you destroyed that sector. You drove them all back to the villages. You lost 20 million jobs by one act of stupidity. So, you know, I think you've got to focus back on that. And when we keep looking at services, we all say services is growing. But services is growing because public sector, public administration consumes 10.4% of the GDP. And that is bounding at 17% a year. Other sectors are not growing. You've got to look at government, reform of government. Modi spoke about reform of government. Manmohan Singh spoke about reform. There's nothing. Government is becoming increasingly expensive. 10.4% of GDP goes on paying government employees. You can't continue this, but you need more government. So you outsource services, you do all these things. Why should a government employee pay 45,000 rupees clean the streets? You outsource all this.
Is all of this, and you know, these are economists, these are policy makers, these are industrialists. The practical politics of India, Jayant Sinha, in conclusion, does it militate against some of the things that we talk in gathering? Labor reform, for example, or cutting down, downsizing government, minimum government, maximum governance. Easier said than done. What is that? Do you have a magic bullet? Do you believe it's very difficult to translate good ideas into practical solutions? Do you have a practical solution to India's job crisis?
No, we are in fact bringing forward many, many practical solutions.
Which Give me
is
the one.
Which is why, I just told you, which is we are saying that we will be implementing a national social security platform for people in the informal sector as well. We are providing healthcare. We are providing through Atal Pension Yojana pensions. So there are a host of ways in which we are strengthening the quality of the jobs in the informal sector. We have provided incentives to create jobs. Dr. Panagariya talked about what we're trying to do in textiles. There's a national textile policy to create jobs in textiles. So in every sector, whatever government can do to facilitate and improve ease of doing business and promote entrepreneurship, we are doing all those things. But recognize that this is a $2.5 trillion economy, 1.3 billion people, maybe a billion people in the workforce in total, hundreds of millions of people in school. There is no easy silver bullet. It takes decades to try and fix some of the structural issues that we have inherited, and we are absolutely doing that. That's why the important thing, and I'll pause here again so that you and the audience recognize this. The important thing to ask ourselves is, are we on the right trajectory or not? Are we taking the right sequence of steps? Are we prioritizing the right policies? And there, I think, without doubt, we can say through the third generation of reforms, the kinds of policy moves we've taken, the kinds of things that we've done to unleash India's business sectors, India's people, is equal to whatever else anybody could have come up with. And they are the best set of policy moves that could have been done to put us on the right trajectory. And it's showing up in the aggregate numbers.
Okay, so you're again going by the third generation of reforms that you keep talking about. Sachin Pilot, we just have 15 seconds. If you were to come to government, and that's still a very, very big if, what is the one thing that you would do that you believe Narendra Modi has not? Give me one thing that you would do that Narendra Modi has not.
Well, first thing we would do, and I think we do as a party, is not give false promises. The fact that today people are falling short of expectations because you promise so much. I think what this government has failed to do, it came out on a reform agenda.
But that's not a solution.
It came out on a reform agenda, and 4 years later, all they're doing is blaming the previous governments. I would actually be much more bold and do reforms that are going to help the economy, and yet spend a lot more on social sector so that people who are disenfranchised don't get left out. The job creation should not be sacrificed because of BJP, Congress, UPA, NDA. The young people of this country deserve a better future, and all of us as politicians have to contribute to doing that. I'm happy to support anything this government does if it brings jobs to our nation. Unfortunately, it's not happening.
Uday Kotak wanted 10 seconds. Yes.
Rajdeep, I think what we need to move is away from a mindset of yesterday's solutions for tomorrow's victory. And our lot of our political discourse, without getting into specific political parties or otherwise, is still focused on how victories of the past were won and what can we learn from them. Tomorrow's victory is very different from whatever we have seen. And if we are thinking about an economy which flourishes, where we see new jobs coming in, we'll have to think differently. The future jobs will be in areas like leisure, wellness, physical trainers. What are we doing to think differently? And we have got to look at jobs not only as salary, also as self-employed. A leisure trainer is working on his or her own. There's an economist study which says, what are the jobs which will remain 10 years from now? There's the most popular jobs will be that of a dentist and a leisure trainer. And a job which will be out of action completely will be that of an accountant. So the world is changing fast, and we are just not keeping pace. We need to think for the future.
Of course, another job that will be soon out 10 years from now is that of a journalist. We'll all be digital. But that's, of course, for another day, another time. We could have discussed automation, which unfortunately we didn't have enough time to do. But maybe that on another day, and what automation will do to the overall job situation. But thank you all very much, all fine minds. Give them a very big hand, ladies and gentlemen.